Human prosperity flourishes by natural gifts and not by gigantic industrial enterprises. The gigantic industrial enterprises are products of a godless civilization, and they cause the destruction of the noble aim of human life. The more we go on increasing such troublesome industries to squeeze out the vital energy of the human being, the more there will be unrest and dissatisfaction of the people in general, although a few only can live lavishly by exploitation. The natural gifts such as grains and vegetables, fruits, rivers, the hills of jewels and minerals, and in seas full of pearls are supplied by the order of the Supreme, and as he desires, the material nature produces them in abundance or restricts them at times. The natural law is that the human being may take advantage of these godly gifts by nature and satisfactorily flourish on them without being captivated by the exploitative motive of lording it over the material nature. The more we attempt to exploit material nature according to our whims of enjoyment, the more we shall become entrapped by the reaction of such exploitative attempts. If you have sufficient grains, fruits, vegetables, and herbs, then what is the necessity of running a slaughterhouse and killing poor animals? A man need not kill an animal if he has sufficient grains and vegetables to eat. The flow of river waters fertilizes the field, and there is more than that we need. Minerals are produced in the hills and the jewels in the ocean. If the human civilization has sufficient grains, minerals, jewels, water, milk, etc., then why should it hanker after terrible industrial enterprises at the cost of labor of some unfortunate men? But all these natural gifts are dependent on the mercy of the Lord. What we need, therefore, is to obedient to the laws of the Lord and achieve the perfection of human life by devotional service. The indication by Kunti Devi are just to point out, just to the point. She desires that the God's mercy be bestowed upon them so that natural prosperity be maintained by His grace. So we are reading from chapter 8 of first canto, where this chapter, the most of the verses are from the prayers of Kunti Maharani. As we all know, Kunti is a pure devotee of the Lord, and in the devotional service, our duty is to progress in the footsteps of the great devotees. So the Kunti Maharani's prayers must be very relevant to us, because that's how we're supposed to see the world. So here, the very important instruction for all of us from this prayer is that how to be happy even in this world. You can see the Kunti Maharani is saying, what is the reason the people can be very happy? How people can be happy? How this world can flourish? And the answer is, Tava ikshitaihi. How people flourish? And she has very solid definition of what is real wealth, what is the reality of life, where when there is a sufficient supakshaushadivirudaha, all the things what is required for human beings to sustain in this world, vanadrina dyudanvanto, and this is what we all require. And how all these things happen? Just by hedante tava vikshitaihi, just by the glance of the Supreme Lord. So this must be a very revealing information for the human race, because generally people are not aware how to actually be happy in this world. To be happy in this world, we require the grace of the Lord one who maintains that. So when that aspect, that the God whose mercy we require, that aspect, when it goes away from the people's mind, there'll be suffering. That's what we see today. And today, there are a lot of suffering which we see. When you open the newspaper and read, and every day we see the lots and lots of news about suffering of people. And mostly from the starting to end, all about suffering of people. And this is not something which is new to our world. This happened in the past when people stopped giving sacrifice to the Lord, stopped actually worshipping the Lord in the past. And that is what is happening. One of the most prominent quality of this age, Kali Yuga, is that people forget God. And people forget God, the next thing happens is there is always shortage of resources. It has been predicted in Srimad Bhagavatam, 12th canto, that what's going to happen in this age, Kali Yuga. It is said in the age of Kali, people will be fully irreligious. This is the first point. People will be irreligious. Irreligious means, it is not talking about the honesty, integrity, which people generally think of. He is a very religious man. Religious means to be obedient to the laws of God. And that aspect, that quality is we are losing in this age called Kali Yuga. So what will happen? Because religiosity is lost, and the next thing happens is suffering. It is said, in this age, as the age passes on, people will be short-lived and their lifespan is going to reduce. Reduce so much that the 50 years will be the maximum lifespan in this age. And if 50 years is the maximum lifespan, imagine 25-30 years is an old man. Somebody asks a question, what is your age? You say, I'm 25. Oh, old man, is it? So that's how the future population is going to be. And there'll be always people will be tormented, the taxes and all kind of difficulties in this society. The government will take tax so much that people will not have for themselves. And all these things are predicted in Bhagavatam. And further, people when they don't have money, don't have anything to eat, they'll be on top of that, the prakriti, the nature will actually make them suffer more by various kinds of calamities. It may be scorching heat, or too much cold, or wind, or heavy rain, and all those things. And on top of that, people quarrel each other, thirst, hunger, and all those things, people will fight each other for resources because resources are at scarce. So in this way, the suffering is increasing because tava ikshitaihi, the Lord's glance is not happening. People are not interested in Lord's glance. The Bhagavatam tells a story of one great king, Angha. So he is in the dynasty of the Manu after Dhruva Maharaj. He was a very religious king and very young. The king was interested to go back to Krishna and render devotional service. So one day when he was performing sacrifices, Ashwamedha Yaga, they observed the Brahmanas who were offering oblations to the sacrifice, they observed that not all devatas are coming to receive their oblations. Something inauspicious things are happening. So king was very unhappy. Why all these inauspicious things are happening? In fact, king didn't have a son. Then later again they perform a sacrifice to have son. And finally, by the process of yajna, they get the prasadam from the yajna, and he feeds that to, king feeds that to his wife Suniti, and they get a child. In fact, the Vena's wife, Suniti, was daughter of death personified. Means she comes from the dynasty of irreligion. Actually, in this material race, there will be always two dynasties going on. Dynasty of religion, dynasty of irreligion. Because always there are people who are interested only in sense gratification. When people who are only in sense gratification, if their interest is only in sense gratification, that is called irreligion. So now, that son who was born, he's already half from the dynasty of irreligion. Maybe this is the reason there was an inauspicious moment when he was performing the sacrifice. So generally it is said that the son is better off of mother and the daughter is better off of father. So son acquired the qualities of mother and mother's father. So definitely predominantly the son had the predominantly irreligion in his mind. And his name was Vena. And this king Vena, he is yet to become king, he is a prince. He was very, very cruel from his young age. Because he is irreligious. He is interested in sense gratification. When a king becomes irreligious, it becomes very difficult. The whole population to live. So, from very young age, they saw some of the qualities of this King Vena. He was very cruel in nature. Unnecessarily, he would go and punish people. Nobody can question the prince in the country. Whatever prince does, others should obey in those days. Sometimes this Vena, when he would go out for playing with children, in the play, he would kill other children. Can you imagine the cruelty which he had? In the play, he would smash others' head and kill them. And he would kill them. So his appearance itself was very cruel. Dark complexion, and he was very cruel in his look. So whenever he would go on the street, people would say, "Oh, cruel Vena has come, cruel." They would actually run away from those places. This is how the prince was. Now you see the Anga, the father was a great devotee. And in fact, he was very unhappy to see such a quality is existing in son's mind. And he tried his best to change his son. He tried to give good lessons to him and tried so many ways. But his son is not ready to correct it. Like you see, Kali Yuga is a plan of the Lord, isn't it? Sometimes Lord wants us to wake up to the reality that this is not the world we are supposed to settle in. And we are supposed to go and do devotional service to the Lord. When we forget this, there will be some kind of ups and downs created by the Lord. So that people don't settle, it's a mercy of the Lord. When the doctor does the operation, it's a mercy of the doctor to the patient. So he revives after that. So there is a suffering. So Vena has come and his father tried his best to change him, but he's not changing. So what to do? Then actually Vena, the king started lamenting. Anga started lamenting. "What an unfortunate person I am. Better not to have son instead of having bad son like this, who's so irreligious, who's only interested in sense gratification." And again he said, "Better to have bad son also, because I get detachment from this material world. When a father gets a bad son, he gets enough of this world. He feels that enough of this world, let me go away somewhere." So Anga started feeling like that, "Better me go." So one day in the night, when everybody is sleeping, without telling anybody, Anga left the palace. The king left the palace to the forest for doing devotional service to the Lord. Next day morning, people are searching, "Where is the king? Where is the king? King is not there." And after searching everywhere, they're not getting the king. And then all the Brahmanas who are giving direction to the king assembled. Now what to do? If king is not there, there will be plunderers and thieves will take away the wealth, the existing wealth of the people, and people will suffer more. There should be king. Unwillingly, Brahmanas felt, at least we should have some king. Let us appoint Vena as king. They were not fully ready for that. In fact, all the ministers in the assembly said, no, he should not become king. But what to do? There was no other choice. They made Vena as king. Now you see, that cruel boy who would kill children even while playing has become king. Imagine now what he can do. As soon as he became a king, he sat on the horse and took sword, went around his country and stopped all the worship and sacrifices which are happening to the Lord. And he said, you should just do sacrifice and worship to me. I am the king. And started actually giving lot of trouble to people. Now again, Brahmanas assembled, what to do now? Actually, they gave an analogy that suppose there is a wood, the stock of wood, log of wood, and one side you burn the wood and there are ants in the wood. And the ants try to move to this side, then you burn the wood from this side also. And the both the sides of the wood log is burning, what would be the experience of the ant? Ant does not know what to do. It goes this side, there is fire. This side, there is fire. And Brahmanas are discussing, the population, the people in this country are in this situation. Go to king, he is one cruel king. And go this side, there are thieves and plunderers. And they are actually suffering. Then all Brahmanas decided, now we should do something. And they said, let us give one try. If he doesn't accept this, then we'll take the serious action against the king. There were very powerful Brahmanas those days. They went to advise the king. In fact, they are the one enthroned the king Vena. But Vena is so actually arrogant that he did not give any respect to the Brahmanas who came for giving advice. And Brahmanas said, my dear king, you see, in the country a lot of suffering is going on. It's because there is no sufficient mercy of the Lord. Tava ikshitaihi is not happening. The Lord is not glancing over because people are not submitting any devotional service to the Lord. Things are not going as on Lord's directions. You as a king, when you make sure that everything goes as per the rule of the Lord, laws of the nature, everything will flourish in the country. Not only that, you will also get benefited. Next life, either you'll go to heaven or you'll go back to Godhead. This is what your duty is. Like this, Brahmanas went and requested the king and reminded the king that is only by Tava Ikshitaihi, by the glance of the Lord, everything can be perfect. But as usual, king was so arrogant. The first thing he told Brahmanas were, you Brahmanas, you're so inexperienced. He's telling Brahmanas, you're so inexperienced. Actually, he is inexperienced. This is how the arrogant people speak and irreligious people speak. Okay. When you say that something good advice to some people, they will say you are very arrogant. So, then king said, see Brahmanas, you don't know what is the truth. Truth is that the king is God. All Brahma, Vishnu, Shiva, all Devatas, Indras, all are supposed to be parts and parcels of king. And you are supposed to worship me and go and teach to people that people should worship me. Brahmanas become very angry because he is bringing down the value of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. They can't keep quiet. So they become very angry and they said, kill him. And they cursed him. They chanted the mantras. They cursed the king and burnt him to ashes. So in this way, the incident takes over and the history goes on. The point which we need to note down is how the glance of the Lord, the mercy of the Lord is required for us to flourish. For us to happy. We can be happy only by when we keep rendering devotional service. When Bhagavatam narration was going on, Parikshit Maharaj was hearing Srimad Bhagavatam from Shukadeva Goswami. Somewhere when, you know, in the Bhagavatam everywhere, many of the places, we hear Narada's glories, the great devotee's glories. Because the Lord's glance is always preceded by his devotee's glance. And devotees glance upon somebody, and naturally, then Lord becomes obligated to glance on them. That is actually the secret of success, Srila Prabhupada says this. So, there is one narration where the Shukadeva Goswami said how actually very materialistic sons of Kuvera, they got liberated by the glance of Narada Muni. When he said this, Parikshit Maharaj became very interested. How is that Nala Kuvera and Manigriva, who are the sons of Kuvera, got liberated and got the highest level of perfection by Narada Muni's glance? So my dear Shukadeva Goswami, can you please explain a little bit more about this? So this is how devotees also ask questions to the saintly people. So Shukadeva Goswami was very keen to explain this. He said, one day when Narada Muni was traveling in Kailasha, in the places and the material creation in different places, in the Sarovara, one day, the two sons of Kuvera, imagine Kuvera is the owner of wealth, you know, and little wealth only is very attractive. Somebody is the son of Kuvera must be, no, they don't know, they born with such a great opulence, Janmaishwarya Shruta Shribhi. They actually born with all the required opulences to do sense gratification. In fact, in Kali Yuga, we have not seen much wealth. In the Kali Yuga, we are poverty stricken. We have not seen actually what is wealth is. Mostly we have seen the things which are made of plastic and various things. We never seen gold properly. Little gold is in protected in the jewelries with the two gunmen outside. Because gold is not so easy to be seen. That's why you see sometimes when people come to our temple, they see, oh, is it gold? They ask. Most of the people ask this question, is this gold? When you say yes, they look and open their mouth and see for some time. Because they have never seen gold like this. And this is how the Kali Yuga is. So, but imagine the sons of Kuvera must be having so much wealth. And they were enjoying. Actually, they were enjoying in Sarovara with women. And Narada happened to pass by. And when they saw Narada, those women who were there with these people, they felt very ashamed and they covered their body because Narada Muni, such a great sage, is passing by. But this Nala Kuvera and Manigriva are so arrogant, so callous. Why? Because Janmaishwarya Shruta Shribhi Edhamana Madhapuman. Actually, when Janmaishwarya Shruta Shribhi, when all these things come, Edhamana Madhapuman, the human being becomes very puffed up, very arrogant. Bhoga Aishwarya Prasaktanam Taya Apahrita Chetasam. Actually, when Bhoga and Aishwarya come, the Taya Apahrita Chetasam, good intelligence goes away. That's why Krishna is called Akinchana Gocharam. Janmaishwarya Shruta Shribhi Edhamana Madhapuman. Naivarahati Abhidhatum Vai Tvam Akinchana Gocharam. Krishna is Gocharam for whom? Krishna is visible for one who is akinchana. Akinchana means one who has exhausted the material wealth, material things. So person who is materially exhausted, it is easy for him to approach God, approach Krishna. Contrary to this is Kubera's sons. So they are not ready. And such a great sage is going, they are just standing naked and they are not ready to give any respect to such a great sage. Narada Muni to teach them a lesson. Actually, Narada Muni is very merciful. Narada Muni's glance has fallen on them. It's sure that they're going to attain the highest perfection in their life. Only the matter of time. So Narada Muni saw them and said, so you people are standing like this naked, like trees. I curse you to become trees. I curse you to become trees in next life. But you see Narada Muni's mercy. After telling that, Narada Muni said, but in that life at the end, you will get a chance to see the Supreme Lord face to face. That time the liberation will happen. This is the special mercy of Narada Muni. The glance of Narada Muni has fallen on them. Now all auspiciousness. When a glance of a pure devotee falls on anybody, there is auspiciousness. So, as per the curse of Narada Muni, these sons took birth as the Arjuna trees in the Vrindavan. In fact, they were so fortunate to take birth where Lord Krishna is going to take birth, because that's what Narada Muni wished. So you all know that story of Damodara, where the Lord takes the wooden mortar. Actually, Lord pulled the wooden mortar. The Yashoda Mai tied the Lord to the wooden mortar, thinking that Lord can't move this wooden mortar. Lord is supreme, he can do anything. He is moving wooden mortar, it's such a great thing. And he is moving wooden mortar, such a small boy is going outside. And he glanced now. Now you see, the glance of the Lord is preceded by the glance of a devotee. Now already Narada Muni has glanced on them. Now the Lord glanced on those trees. And Lord felt, Krishna felt, that I have nothing to do with these trees. I have no business with these trees. But still, my great devotee, my dear devotee, Narada Muni has wished so. So I should do something. In fact, Krishna thinks like this. I have nothing to do with these trees. But my devotee wished so. So I should do something. Then Krishna slowly moves in between the two trees. Neither the rope which was tied on Krishna was so strong, nor the wooden mortar was strong. On material calculation, even Krishna, the small boy, is not so strong. But Krishna just moved in between the trees and pulled down such a big, gigantic trees down. When the trees fell down, so these two personalities got liberated, and just in a folding hands, they stood in front of the Lord, begging the Lord, saying, the Lord, Lord, we are so grateful to you. Lord, we in fact so grateful to Narada Muni, our spiritual master, who enlightened us, who gave us this boon to see you. And my dear Lord, we can't understand you. You're a small boy, what you're doing, we can't understand. We can only pay our obeisances unto you. This is the prayer which those sons of Kuvera do to the Lord. Lord, we can't understand you. We can only pay obeisances unto you. We can only beg your glance. That is your greatness. So in this way, we see how the glance of the Lord is so important in our life. That is why the Satyavrata Muni prays in the Damodara Astaka, that's Krupa Drishti Vrishtyati Dhinam Batanu. Krupa Drishti Vrishtyati. Krupa Drishti, Lord, please shower Krupa Drishti of yours. Dhinam Batanu, I'm so fallen. I require your mercy. Namo Deva Damodarananta Vishnu. Prasida Prabho Dukkha Jalabdi Magnam. Krupa Drishti Vrishtyati Dhinam Batanu. So this is what a devotee should be thinking. This is how actually the person can really become auspicious. Things become auspicious in person's life. This is Very important understanding what Kunti Maharani is saying, because when the pure devotee glances and we request the glance of a pure devotee, the pure devotee in turn will reflect, actually request Lord's glance. You see how when Narada Muni glanced, he requested the Lord, you please get a glance upon them. That phenomena we can see in this verse where Kunti Maharani is saying, Hedyante, Hedante, Tavavikshitaihi. They will ask for Lord's glance. We ask for Lord's devotee's glance. This is the right understanding of spiritual life. And once Narada Muni was going. In fact, Narada Muni is known for preaching, known for liberating people from this material world. Narada Muni did not care. Some people cursed him. Some people said that you are not a Muni. You are simply in the garb of a saint. You are not a saint. You don't have heart. You are taking away our children and making them Krishna conscious. You are heartless. And all these things, curses Narada Muni heard in his life. And he keep on hearing such things, and people actually sometimes scold him and all those things. But still, Narada Muni is undaunted, because Narada Muni knows what is the real well-being of people. So mercifully he travels everywhere. It's the mercy of Narada Muni that he travels everywhere and tries to give this ultimate knowledge to people. So one day when Narada Muni was going, this is mentioned in Chaitanya Charitamrita, where Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu explains this to Sanatana Goswami. When Narada Muni was going like that in the forest, in the road, where he saw one deer was half killed. Somebody shot an arrow to deer, and deer was suffering. Leg is broken. And with full of pain, the deer is actually, don't know what to do. Some hunter has shot an arrow. Narada Muni felt very compassionate and moved little more steps ahead. He saw another boar in same situation. The boar is half killed, and boar is also suffering and suffering in the blood, rolling in the blood and suffering. And again Narada Muni felt, what is this? And he moved another few steps ahead. He saw another rabbit doing that. The rabbit also is shot an shot an arrow, and rabbit is actually again suffering and suffering, is in the verge of death. Now Narada Muni, as a devotee of the Lord will have good qualities. He felt very compassionate. Who is this person doing like this? And he observed very carefully. He saw there was a hunter hiding behind a tree. And Narada Muni just left his path and started moving towards hunter to speak to that hunter. Why is he doing so? As Narada Muni approaching and identified the hunter and moving, you see the hunters always hide behind somewhere so that those poor animals, they don't identify, they think nobody is there, and freely they start moving. Then hunter shoots an arrow. That's why this hunter was hiding behind. When Narada Muni started moving towards hunter, and animals also saw there is hunter. The few animals which were there around in the forest, they also saw there is an hunter. By seeing the ferocious look of hunter, and by seeing the hunter, the animals fled away. Now Narada Muni moved a little more closer to the hunter. Hunter was very unhappy, because he was just about to shoot another arrow to another animal. By seeing this Narada Muni coming, and the animal saw him also, and the animal ran away. He lost that animal. So now the hunter became very angry. But in fact, the hunter had little good quality. I think hunter is not from Kali Yuga. He had better respect to the saint. So saint dress he is coming. And he said, dear sage, what is that you wanted? You see, because you came, I lost that animal. He fled away. Why are you doing like this? Why are you disturbing my duty? It's my duty. It's my dharma. I'm doing karma yoga. It's like that. So, hunter was a little unhappy about Narada Muni's arrival. Narada Muni said, I just wanted to know who you are and what you are doing. Hunter said, my name is Mrugari. Mrugari means, Mruga means animal, Ari means the enemy. My name itself, enemy of animals. So I'm doing my duty. Sometimes people argue like that, saying that I'm doing my duty. You go and tell them, please come to temple and chant Hare Krishna. See, for me, work is worship. I need not to come to temple. Okay, for me, the work is God and I am doing. This is my duty. My duty I am doing. By doing duty, this is karma yoga, I will go back to Godhead. That is, go back to Godhead, of course, they don't have that idea. But they say that, I am perfect man. This is how the hunter is also thinking. My father is also a Mrugari. He taught me this. He taught me how what to do and I am doing the same. I am doing my duty. In the Bhagavad Gita, Lord said, you should do your duty and I am doing my duty. So, and Mrugari further said, what I do is actually, I shoot an arrow and an animal gets an arrow, then after that it's definitely going to die. I don't kill that animal immediately. I enjoy seeing that animal suffering. Can you see the mentality of the hunter? People enjoy seeing others suffering. This is the mentality of demons. Demons are the one who ready to take any sense gratification at the cost of others' suffering. That's what's happening in today's world. That's called Ravan. In the Ramayana, the Ravan, the meaning of word Ravan means the one who takes pleasure in others' suffering. So this is Ravan. And you see that today's population in Kali Yuga, the most of the population are Ravans because they don't mind what happens to others. They don't care. They just want to make their money and their happiness. So this is what Mrugari is thinking also, that I take pleasure in that suffering. In fact, Narada Muni, being very powerful sage, he said, my dear hunter, can I beg you something? Can I request you something? And Mrugari said, of course, you are a great sage. What do you want? Which animal you want? You can tell me, I can give you. Or you want skin? I have deer skin, tiger skin. To do your meditation, I can offer all those skins to you. You want all those things? Narada Muni said, no, I don't want any of those things. I want to tell you something very important. Then Narada Muni started revealing him the knowledge of soul and knowledge of eternality. And Narada Muni said, all those animals whom you are killing now, they will kill you in the future. Do you know how much suffering is waiting for you? For all the actions which you are doing? Like this, Narada Muni started explaining what's going to happen to him in the future. Hearing this with the attention and the faith with Narada Muni, this is one of the good qualities which Mrugari had. He was hearing to him with faith. And he heard that and he actually became afraid. And he said, oh great sage, now what to do then? You're saying that I will suffer like this in the future. Then what is the solution? You tell me, I don't know what to do. Then the Narada Muni said, for that, you should give up what you are doing. And you should take up devotional service. No, sage, you tell me, you protect me, whatever you say, I will do. Then Narada Muni said, first you break your bow. So Narada Muni is asked very highest demand. See, the pure devotees of the Lord are very straightforward. They are not telling, okay, you come to me, I will help you, and you slowly start doing this, and after that I will talk to you, and all those things. He is not there to appease him. Narada Muni has not gone to Mrugari to somehow to get Mrugari as his follower. That was not the idea of Narada Muni. Narada Muni is very straightforward. He said, he gave such an instruction that he is an hunter and he is telling the hunter, you break your bow. Means you give up your profession. Actually, the Mrugari is first time receiving such a straightforward instruction. He said, if I break my bow, what will I do for my food? People ask this, no, if you chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare, who will offer you food? Who will work? Stop chanting and go and work. It's in this way, in this thinking. So the Mrigari said that, how will I survive? And anyway, Naradamuni said, you don't worry. I'll supply everything for you. You just do whatever I said. So Mrigari became very convinced. He broke his bow, actually surrendered to Naradamuni. And Naradamuni said, now you go home, tell your wife that what has happened, and your wife distribute all the remaining wealth to people and brahmanas there who are spiritually inclined, and then you go for the somewhere near the river and take shelter there, make one small hut there and sit there and glorify the Lord. Chant the holy names of the Lord. So now the Mrigari has accepted and he did all those things, and having full faith in Narada Muni, he went to the river bank and started chanting. And Narada Muni said that you should keep a tulsi plant in front of your house and every day circumambulate the Tulsi Maharani. Yani kanicha papani brahma hatyadi kanicha. So you have done so much sinful activities, you have to get purified. So Narada Muni gave all the methods to get purified. And Mrigari is thinking, my spiritual master asked me to break my bow and everything he has done, he has taken away everything. Now who is going to supply? So he was sitting and chanting. And this news spread everywhere in the village. Because Mrigari was known for his cruelty. And that, when it spread all over the village, that one, the great sage Narada has changed the mind of that Mrigari. And Mrigari has become saint. People wanted to go and see that saint. So people started going with a lot of offerings to the saint. This is another understanding which you should have. When we go to a saintly person, devotee of the Lord, when you go to the Lord, we are not supposed to go empty-handed. We're supposed to carry something. When you go to temple, we're supposed to take something. Srila Prabhupada says, these days people don't have these qualities. People go empty-handed to the God and ask from God, please give me. Actually, it should be other way wrong. We supposed to carry to the Lord. Lord, I just wanted to your mercy. I want your devotional service and offer something what we have in our ability to the God. That should be our understanding. Not go to empty-handed in front of Krishna and ask Krishna, please give me that and give me this. So people started going to Mrigari and started offering many, many things. So this was very nice. That so many, actually Mrigari got offerings, even 20-30 people can have food. Mrigari got bewildered. My spiritual master is so powerful. So he's supplying so many things. He's sending so many things. He's very merciful. So in this way, the Mrigari got attained the highest perfection by the blessings, by the glance of the pure devotee, Narada Muni. So these are the very important understandings we should have, that how to get the glance of a pure devotee. It's a kripa. Sometimes by kripa of a pure devotee, we all have come to Krishna consciousness by the kripa of a pure devotee. And we are in very special parampara of Chaitanya parampara. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mercy is flowing through our parampara by Srila Prabhupada's mercy. So one day, in the hellish planet, where Yamaraj and his assistants, Yamaraj has many assistants, and Yamaraj has his accountant assistant, who is Chitragupta, they were all talking, oh, now Kali Yuga has come, you know, we'll have a lot of, heavy service now. So people will be coming, when Janmashtami is coming, a lot of heavy service we have, and a lot of people are coming. So now Kali Yuga is coming, and the rate at which the souls are coming to hell has increased. So they were doing all these discussions now, what to do. At that time, Narada Muni comes there. So Narada Muni is known for going everywhere and, propagating Lord's glories. And he knows everything, what's happening in the world. So that's the mercy of the Lord unto him. So then, Narada Muni said, you know one thing, Yamaraj? There is one place in the material world you lost your jurisdiction over there. From there, nobody will come for your kingdom. And Yamaraj asks, what's that special? Which place it is? Actually, this particular incident, the history comes in Chaitanya Mangala by Vrindavan Das Thakur. And Narada Muni says, that's the place where the Supreme Lord has appeared as Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu there. And actually there is a great mercy program is going on. And once the Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has come there, you don't have any jurisdiction, you don't have any rights over there. This is something very astonishing news Narada Muni has brought. How is it possible? And they didn't believe, and of course, Yamaraj said, your Supreme Lord has incarnated, it's very great. Anything is possible. I'm very curious. So shall we go and see that place? Shall we once go and see what's happening there? So Narada Muni said, of course, we can go there and see in the Navadvip, where Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's pastimes are going on, holy name is going on. Let's see and what's happening there. I'm ready for that. So Yamaraja and Narada Muni got ready to go. Then Chitragupta said, why are you leaving me and you're going? I also want to come and see what's happening. So in this way, all of them joined and they all decided, along with all the people of the hell, they're all going to see the place of Navadvipa and what's the pastime going on there. So they went there to see. They saw the great Sankirtana parties are going on. Nityananda Prabhu, Haridas Thakur going everywhere and preaching people to chant Hare Krishna. Because this is the mantra which is going to liberate. We discussed in the beginning how Kali Yuga is full of suffering. And this explanation is given by Shukadeva Goswami in Srimad Bhagavatam. But after this explanation, actually, Shukadeva Goswami also gives solution. Kali Yuga is full of faults like this. Kaler dosha nidhe rajan, but asti eka mahan guna, kirtana deva krishnasya. But unfortunately, nobody is doing kirtana deva krishnasya. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has come personally and he is doing that. So by seeing this, actually they liked it. They were just enjoying what's happening in Navadvip. All Narada Muni and Yamaraja and Chitragupta, they are watching and enjoying all those things. So meantime, when they're observing, at the same point, one incident happened. There are two drunkards, two materialistic men, took birth in Brahmana family. It is said in Bhagavatam, in Kali Yuga, the people will claim as I am Brahmana just by birth and one thread. They don't follow any rules. So this way, this Jagai and Madai, who are from the Brahmana's family, they're so degraded. They became women hunters. They were doing all kinds of sinful activities. And Nityananda Prabhu mercifully went there. Haridas Thakur mercifully went there. They hit Nityananda Prabhu. And when this is happening, Narada Muni and Yamaraja are watching. And Chitragupta said, yes, yes, here are my people. You said that nobody will come. Here are the people there for me. And Chitragupta and Yamakinkaras and they all said, they should be immediately punished. How can they do this to Nityananda Prabhu? They're so sinful. They're definitely going to come to hell. No excuse for them. Whatever Narada Muni has told is false. Narada Muni said, no, they are not going to come. Why? Narada Muni said, very important thing. Once Nityananda Prabhu's glance has fallen on them, they will not come to hellish planet at all. So this is actually the glory of the glance of the Lord. Tava vikshitaihi. So now, you know then what happens. Then Nityananda, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu becomes angry. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu goes. Nityananda Prabhu stops them. Finally, they become great devotees. They don't go to hell. This is the power of Sri Chaitanya's movement. श्री चैतन्य महाप्रभु इज नमो महावदान्याय कृष्ण प्रेम प्रदायते इज रेडी टू गिव टू एवरीबडी द मर्सी. सो दिस इज द पोजिशन ऑफ श्री चैतन्य महाप्रभु. सो ओनली थिंग विच चैतन्य महाप्रभु रिक्वेस्ट अस विच विल हेल्प अस to get the glance of a pure devotee, which will help us to get the glance of the Lord, is chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare. Srila Prabhupada said, actually, we need not to struggle hard in our life to see God. Srila Prabhupada said, my spiritual master Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur used to say, we should not do all those things. We should work in such a way that God will see us. This is the right understanding. We should not be hankering to see God. Rather, we should work in such a way that God will see us. God will glance upon us. This is what is required. This is the understanding which Kunti Devi is giving in today's verse. Lord's glance is important. Not that our glance upon the Lord, that has no value many times. We require Lord's glance on our devotee, ourself, and we require the glance of devotee on ourself. In Srila Prabhupada's pastime, this is told by one of the devotee. He was a driver. In fact, he was driving the vehicle when Prabhupada would come. It was in England. Once Prabhupada was actually visited the England, their manor, and then Prabhupada was going back to airport. And when Prabhupada would go back to airport, lot of devotees would follow. They would do lot of kirtan and so many vehicles. Prabhupada will be in another one car and so many cars will follow like a parade behind Prabhupada. And this devotee was in one of the cars and he was a driver. And he was just sitting like this, and Prabhupada's car, which was behind him, because Prabhupada's car is supposed to go in the front, and it was just started, and slowly Prabhupada's car overtook his car, and Prabhupada was just moving in that car to the front. And Prabhupada was sitting the left rear the door of the car, and this driver, you know, the right side in England. So Prabhupada actually looked like this and looked at this driver devotee intensely for 2 to 3 seconds, and Prabhupada glanced upon him, and that devotee shares his experience. That 2 to 3 seconds of Prabhupada's glance when he was just crossing in the car was very electrifying, very purifying. It was directly touching to my soul. And I felt that here is a person, I should do everything for him. And from that point, I became very serious in Krishna consciousness. Can you see the power of a glance of a devotee? How the devotee can glance, and how devotees can feel so electrified and purified by the glance. One more incident, another devotee says, there he was at, Prabhupada was arriving to their temple. His service was to the reception. He was holding the garland, to put garland to Prabhupada when he comes. And they were all ready now, Prabhupada comes, they all rehearse now. You know, they do some rehearsal when Prabhupada comes out to put garland and all those things they plan. So this devotee was holding garland and being ready for actually offering that to Prabhupada. And the moment came, Prabhupada arrived. You know, Prabhupada arrived, that the environment become fully spiritualized and full with kirtan and with the big entourage of disciples, he is coming. And this devotee who is supposed to put garland, holding garland in his hand like this, and Prabhupada is coming around, he's looking at Prabhupada, and Prabhupada looked at him. He's just stunned and frozen, and Prabhupada passed by, he did not put garland. Then he came to the senses that I was supposed to put garland, ran, and again he has slid the garland to Prabhupada's head. And it was a little odd, but devotee says that when Prabhupada looked at me, That was such an electrifying experience. Prabhupada's glance was so powerful that I felt I got purified from many things. I just felt I'm frozen there. So this is actually the power of a glance of a devotee. As we have seen in the stories of Srimad Bhagavatam and in Chaitanya Charitamrita, the glance of a devotee will be definitely give the blessings, and glance of the Lord will definitely happen on that person, because glance of the devotee is very powerful. Now, how to get the glance of a devotee? Getting a glance of devotee in this particular time is very easy for us by the mercy of Srila Prabhupada. And we need to simply render our possible devotional service to our Guru. Many times we are very satisfied that I am chanting every day, I am eating only prasadam, I visit temple, I attend festivals. Actually, to please Guru, one of the very important aspects is tadviddhi pranipatena paniprashnena sevaya. We need to do sevaya of the Guru. We should render practical devotional service to Guru. When we render practical devotional service to Guru, then there is a special mercy which will flow from Guru. Divya Gyan Hrude Prakashito will happen, because that's how the glance of a devotee will fall. So we should never become lethargic, thinking that now I am doing everything what is there in Krishna consciousness. We should always hanker, how can I do more to my spiritual master? That's how Srila Prabhupada exhibited this quality. He would again and again ask Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur that how can I do more to you? My dear spiritual master, your other disciples are so much they are doing for you. I am being grihastha, I am not able to do much for you. Please tell me, what can I do for you? This is what the thinking we should always carry in our heart. How can I do to my spiritual master? How can I do more for spiritual master? When we do that, spiritual master will become very pleased, and spiritual master will glance upon that, and spiritual master, being a pure devotee, in turn requesting Lord to glance, tava ikshitaihi, we will get the glance of the Lord. That is a success in this human form of life. So that's what Kunti Maharani is saying, and Srila Prabhupada says this is actually the perfection that we need to achieve, the glance of the Lord. So tava vikshitaihi. So we'll stop here. Srila Prabhupada ki, Granthara Srimad Bhagavatam ki.